Which, as a Gonzo blogger, which way is it best to hold it? That way or that way?
It's better like this.
Otherwise, it goes thin.
Yeah.
So, here we are in this magnificent, vast sports hall, which is a kind of Soviet era, I guess.
University.
It's got a running track around it and
it's quite
impressive, I have to say.
Quite impressive. Here they have a rocodrome, they have installations. Have been many important people, no, playing here or training, no, students. No? It's a wonderful installation, no? Of the Donetsk National Technical University. It's the biggest university here in Donetsk. No?
Should we move away from the?
Yeah.
We'll go to the show.
Equipment.
There is a rock climbing.
I know, this is very interesting, no? Actually, before there is also there a swimming pool, that's amazing, you saw, no?
Yes, 25 meters
of hot water. And also they have an area for barbecues and parties, let's say, no, for activities, social activities. You can find here this for football, handball, these kind of things, no? I think it's 50 or 40 different sports here.
Right.
Because they have 55 trainers here. And also they have a physiotherapist and a doctor. Even, you know?
Take it seriously.
Yeah. Oh, come on. The culture here is in this area, from the Soviet Union, is a sport. You know that the Soviet Union was very strong in that, no? Yeah.
They haven't lost that.
No, still no. Those guys have this, the light sport, no? Not like me, no? That's all I have to say. My sport is drinking beer, no? And posting my crap, no, on Facebook. This is what I am doing. Those people are taking that very seriously. This is for, you see, the flag of the Donetsk People's Republic. It's interesting.
Oh, boxing ring.
Boxing. Wow. Not only boxing, also Muay Thai, this kind of martial arts, also. I don't know. I get here just rarely, and not for doing a sport, but for trying to do something. No? It's very interesting here. And also for, how to call it in English, I forgot now. With arc.
Yeah.
Like a Robin Hood, no?
Archery.
Archery. You want to be Robin Hood, you can practice there. Olympic arch.
Huh? That's what that is.
Doesn't
show up very well on the
camera. A lot of good things, because they were providing with education for free, not only to the citizens of here, but also for many foreigners. Many foreigners came to study here to Donetsk from developing countries.
Africa, Asia.
The other day I had a barbecue with people from Ethiopia, Somalia, Nigeria. People that are living here for many years. They came here to study. They met here. And now they are here still, and they are supporting the rebellion, no? The rebellion against the this kind of semi-Nazi regime, no? Yeah. Because they are not even so good for being Nazis. They are semi-Nazis. It's even worse. Do you know what I mean? Because unless some Nazis have some sort of culture. Those people are without any culture. Lumpen.
So Miguel,
associated with weapons, no? I mean, yes.
So Miguel. You've travelled a lot around Eastern Europe, and I was places like Ukraine, Kiev.
Lithuania, all the Baltic states, Poland, Bulgaria.
What was, you're from Barcelona, so what was your interest? What brought you to Eastern Europe?
I was not really especially interested. My life pushed me there, no? Because I started to work in the framework of the Youth in Action program. funded by the European Union, and they, you know,
Erasmus.
It's a kind of Erasmus,
but Erasmus triple plus.
Yeah. But then I start to travel and organizing activities. Well, very active, I say, many, quite a lot of years, with projects, no? And later, well, I met in one of the projects that I participated. I met a girl, no, from Lithuania, and then I moved to Lithuania. I decided to move to Lithuania. And since then, I am doing that. I mean, just living in the east, no? And now, really, this is the east. Start to be the far east, no? Because I don't know what is going to happen to me. I should learn Russian, that's for sure. And then, I know, in the future, now look, I spent here 9 months, no? Trying to work and adapting myself to this environment, no? It's difficult, no? But now my project is continue working on international projects, no? Here.
Yeah.
Blogging, of course, writing serious stuff. And learn Russian. This is going to be one of my challenges, no? But just two hours per day. I say, Miguel, change your chip, because my problem is that I have the chip of tourists still. You know, it's the chip of the tourists that you visit a place, and you know, you really are not integrated into society, no? And me, I'm pretty integrated, I have to say, because I'm working here, no? I have a lot of people around, no? But I think this is my challenge, that I will start as soon as possible.
And you left Lithuania last year to come here. You were working at the university there. What was the story behind that?
The history was that, well, I was working there for near 10 years already, no? In Kaunas, in the second city of Lithuania.
Well, teaching.
I started to work first in Klaipeda, in a university, American university that is in Klaipeda. Later, I moved to Vilnius, working there, you know. I have been working, and later, finally, in Kaunas. I stayed there. I was kind of happy, no? There. But the problem is that I went to Odessa in 2013. It was in a project funded by the European Union, Erasmus for Plus.
This
And then
later,
it was in August. In August, at the beginning of September, and later I came back to Kaunas, I started to decision to teach, no, again, no. And in November I went to Lviv, because I was invited by friends to go to Lviv. And then I saw the Maidan started there, actually, in Lviv. I saw those far right elements there, no, collecting signatures against Yanukovych, of the Svoboda Party, and also other groups, no. And then later I came back to Lithuania and the Maidan started. I just simply, the propaganda in Lithuania was so nasty. It was, first, they were against Yanukovych. They wanted to remove him. All the media against Yanukovych, against Yanukovych, against Yanukovych. And later, when the Maidan took, those guys took the power, supporting them, and then against the Donbass, you know. They created Grybauskaitė, President Grybauskaitė, the president of Lithuania, in this process of 3 years, transformed Lithuania in a country that was semi-democratic in a kind of authoritarian regime, because they are hunting, it's like this, they are hunting political opposition. I mean, the main victims of the Maidan in Lithuania has been the freedom of speech and the freedom of thought. Many teachers and employees, public employees, has been kicked out from their jobs. I know the case of two, three professors or lecturers, Lithuanians, no? Not me, I am a foreigner, no? And also even a guy that was a veterinarian working for the public services, also removed because they were posting against the Poroshenko and against the foreign policy of Lithuania. Okay, and it happened to me the same. They told me, the security services, the BSD, is the kind of the KGB of Grybauskaitė, sent some message, contacted the rector, and they told me, look, Miguel, you have to stop, you have to close your Facebook account. You cannot write anymore, because you know you cannot work here. And then, after 2 days thinking what I had to do, I decided not to stop. I continue to posting more and more, with more, even more. You understand, you know? Because I think that the freedom of speech and thought is one of the most important values in Western culture. seminar. I believe in the freedom of speech. This is the basic for in a democratic society. In Lithuania, there is no democracy. There is an authoritarian dictatorship. Many people are scared because also they are kicking out people from jobs. Not only that, it's very nasty. They are even calling by phone to your friends, contacting your friends, telling your friends why they are your friends, because you are an enemy of Lithuania.
And essentially, they told you to leave. Stop logging.
Basically, after 1 year living in this condition, I lost my job. I lost all my jobs because I was working not only in this university, Vytautas Magnus University of Kaunas. It's like a second of the country, but also I appear in the media, Lithuanian media. Depicted as an agent, a provocateur, a very dangerous person.
One of Putin's
agents, trolls.
Internet trolls.
Exactly. I was paid by Putin, and I was intoxicating the students with my propaganda. Something that was true because my students know perfectly that I never was speaking, never, because I'm a professional. I never was speaking about politics on my lectures. You know? Basically it's done. This is my history. I was very, very sad because I had to leave this university. Donetsk National Technical University contacted me. I had some followers. They were teachers from this university. They contacted me and they told me, look, Miguel, we need some teachers, you know, some foreign lecturers here or professors. And also somebody that is able to help us in the international area, you know, to develop international contacts. Something that I am doing because, look, if you are here, it's because me. Yeah, simply, thanks to this somehow this group of Italian group contacted us, no, contacted me actually, no, to help them to come to Donetsk. You understand, you know? Banda Bassotti, and also this EU member of the EU Parliament. No, this woman that she's member of the European Union Parliament. She came here 2 days ago, and we organized an anti-fascist forum. Eh? And also we visited the university. We visited the rectorate. That's because me, no, because my small organization, I created here a cultural organization, the Centro Cervantes, Centro Cervantes de Donetsk. And well, you saw the group. We have a nice group, no, of people, no, that we were helping in everything that you need here, no. I mean, helping the foreigners, looking for places, no, even doing as a translators, as a volunteers. You understand me, no?
Tell us, Miguel. You talked about your NGO, which was connected to the European Union originally, but now you're very critical of the EU. And what was the thing that changed your attitude towards it?
Well, it changed my attitude. It started to change when, especially during the bombing, when they bombed, let's say, Libya, in the Libyan war. I was very criticizing very much. No? The position of some European countries, no? what we are doing in Libya. But later, in the coup of Maidan and the massacre in Odessa, it was the massacre in Odessa, I simply say, you know, I don't want to know anything else. I consider myself pro-European, but the problem is that Europe, the European Union, morphed into a... I consider the European Union is a kind of semi-fascist, even, no? It is walking, it is towards the fascism.
Yeah, yeah.
It's morphing. You understand me? The people don't understand that the historically it happens that the countries even or the regimes can change. No? And something that was more or less open and more or less democratic has becoming authoritarian, all the time more authoritarian and more interventionist. More interventionist. Eh? Using this ideology, that's an ideology, the humanitarian interventionism. Say, as an excuse for destroying countries, for destroying sovereign countries. This is a pure imperial way of thinking. I mean, all the empires are looking for justification for their wars. No? In the times of the Spanish, also we went to America to help them to become good Christians.
Yes.
You understand me, no?
Yes.
And during the
civilization.
Yeah. No. The British Empire, you are British
civilization. The barbarians.
Exactly. Let's see. You know, the imperialists never are thinking that they are bad guys. They are thinking that they are good. That they are helping others to be more civilized, no? More civilized, no? Providing them civilization and education. Now it's the same. We are helping others, the European Union is helping others to become democratic and also free. You understand, you know?
Yep.
And this is just pure propaganda. So it's disgusting. It's disgusting. They have been bombed here at this university. The European Union. I tell them, the Europeans are supporting the bombing of this university, the Donetsk National Technical University, that has been bombed by the squads, the death squads of the Maidan, far right battalions that came here to kill people. They killed even a teacher here, and they 80 persons were employees and also students were injured. Some of them really injured, no, with had a lot of problems. No? Look, and this university, the rectorate, you saw with your eyes. It was bombed. It was, sorry, but and then this is those are facts with a heavy artillery attacking. This is a university. You understand? And then this is the thing that the European Union is supporting. Myself, I consider a person quite liberal in my way of thinking. It means liberal means that I respect the freedom of speech of the people. You understand me, no? And also the right of the people to express each other, and everything should be, decided by the people in a free elections, not by coups and wars. And also, especially in Ukraine, that the European Union is supporting a regime where the Nazis or the neo-Nazi element are a very important part of this situation, because the far right battalions are here, and not only that, they were very important key element in the Maidan, because they were the people with the weapons, they were attacking the police. Without them, the Maidan was not possible. They were the armed squad of people.
And they were funded by the oligarchs as well.
Funded by the oligarchs and trained. You understand me? And so they organized a coup. You understand me? Here it looks like those girls are going to dance. You know, now here it's always for your followers are more interested than me. You understand me? You know, because probably.
So, what were your feelings when the British voted to leave the European Union with Brexit?
Well, I think that I knew that Brexit was the result of this referendum. I knew, and I remember that the night I was in Kaunas in that moment, the night of the referendum, all the I was following BBC directly in live. No, I remember those analysts, political analysts, that they were saying, no, this is not possible. Brexit will never win. This is not possible. And later it appeared a mathematician. Statistics, a guy experienced statistics, say, look, according to the first 2% of the votes, they were counting the votes, and start to appear the first results in some small circumscriptions that should be very liberal, very pro European Union, and they were not getting enough good results there. And he say, my prognosis is that the Brexit is going to be the outcome of this referendum. All the analysts say, wow, what are you saying? You are stupid. This is not possible. You cannot say it. Sorry, but this is it was obvious since the beginning. Look, the Brexit, I think, is a good thing for Britain, in my opinion. And also, the European Union should be dismantled. That's it. As soon as possible. It's going to be a very painful process. It's going to be a painful process that the European Union is going to be dismantled, because the euro is in the long run is unsustainable. You understand me? It's provoking really terrible economic problems, especially in southern countries like Spain, Greece, Portugal. And also, the euro is only good for the German economy, basically. You understand? Mm-hmm. And it's an imposition, actually, you know, of the Germans. Actually, all the project of the European Union is it's a German project. It's behind that is the interest of Germany and United States. Mm-hmm. Pay attention that the European Union is an idea that was promoted by the CIA. There are the documents there. Jean Monnet, Jan Moneda is the so-called father of the European Union. Jan Moneda is actually he was working for the CIA. I mean, he the general de Gaulle considered him an agent of the United States, and the classified documents that you can find everywhere show that the CIA was behind the so-called European project, because they wanted to, first of all, somehow for them is the United States is better dealing, no, with one center of power, central power that is in Brussels, that with different countries, you know. And also in that we have to analyze also the political scenario in that time, that it was Europe was divided into areas, no, the socialist area and the other area that was controlled by the United States. The United States had a very important role, no, in the creation of the European Union. And now, well, they are expanding, no, they start to expand, not only the European Union, also NATO. NATO as an aggressive military alliance, no? That they are everywhere, no? So and they arrived here till those people, the people on Donbass, were able to stop them. They have been able to stop them with you saw the militias here. They are local people that have two weapons. And why in Donbass? Well, there is an explanation for that. Here, this is was the center of the former Soviet Union in the steel makers. They are steel makers. They are the coal industry here is very important. All the guys here are able to do something with the hands. Yeah, are very good in repairing things. You take a full of engineers. This university have created thousands and thousands of engineers of all kind of engineering, no? Mechanic, especially mechanics, this kind of things, no? And then they are able to fix everything.
And Donbass has always been like a red belt.
And also that they have this ecology of very, very working class area, industrial area, no? So this city was occupied by the Nazis. This city was destroyed.
World War II.
Yeah, during the World War II. And many people were killed here. So those people remember about that. You understand me? And this is because they were very against the because they know that the people that were in the Maidan, many of them were kind of Nazis or very far right elements. You understand me? No? So this is the truth. I mean, here those people took the weapons and all tanks and they repaired that and that's it.
And one last thing, Miguel. Before we go for a pivo,
yeah. We have to go to the center, to the rectorate, yes.
One last thing, you use some quite colourful language to describe people in your Gonzo blogging.
Colourful?
Yeah, colourful, yeah. Like...
neologisms, no? I use neologisms.
You use words like... just trying to think...
Eurotard.
Eurotard, Eurotard. Have you got a few more other examples you can...
I have a lot of... I like to use neologisms, you understand? Yeah. You say, yes, a colorful language, you know, say, no. Well, I do that because... I suppose it's because it's more interesting, no? It's more funny, no? You know, I love creating words, no? And also analyzing what, because, you know, I like to analyze, no, what the media, the big media like BBC are saying, no? And sometimes I'm using their own narrative, but inverted, you know, inverted, no? I mean, just the opposite, no? Actually, I like writing in general. In Spanish, for instance, some people think that in Spanish I write pretty good, you understand, you know, because, quite kind of literature, actually, you know. I like writing poetry, you know, for many years. For me, working with words is very, very easy. I mean, it's funny, it's very interesting. And also, in Facebook, for me, it's the best platform for that, you know, because you start to have a lot of people that read your stuff, you know, and then you have an immediate impact on people, you understand, you know? And then this is I like some words like Eurotar or Europe, no, Europe or the or or the liberal Teletubby inferno, no? This is the liberal Teletubby inferno.
Liberal
Teletubby.
Retard media.
Yeah, retard media. The retard media. The retard media is the thing that we are having. No, I know. It's very aggressive. It's a sarcastic, even sometimes unpolite. Exactly. This is the thing that I am looking for. It's the style based on the ideas of Hunter Thompson. No, it's the Gonzo journalism. No,
yeah.
That he was using also this kind of techniques, because it's a technique for having an impact. And an insult, properly, you do in a funny way, you know, it's an insult, but somehow you are doing not really low level, but with some kind of imagination, so the retards, no, feel even more offended, you understand me? So because you are showing some level of, some degree of let's say, you are treating them as an idiot, you understand me? No? And then there is nothing worse for a retard, like the Euro retard, that somebody show them the truth in an humoristic way. You understand? Using humor. Humor is and sarcasm are tools against this kind of people. No? That I consider them really people that it's like the guys that in the times of the medieval age, no, the Trinity, you know, defending the Trinity or you know, the Virgin Maria or this kind of things. No? The Virgin Maria was a dogma. Those Eurotars are also defending a dogma, the dogma of the European Union, the European dream. I read some analysts, they call them, there's a guy that used other concept, like Eurofanatics. Mm-hmm. Eurofanatics, so, well, the Eurofanatics is, I call them Eurotars, no? Euroturks, no? I mean, people that are unable to accept the truth. The truth is that the European Union is a fiasco, it's a huge fiasco, and has destroyed, is destroying right now the economies of many countries, and is in total chaos, and it's collapsing. And as soon as we notice that, and we understand, the project, there is Varoufakis, Gianni Varoufakis, the Greek, he wants to reform the European Union. Sorry, guy, the European Union cannot be reformed. It's a total mess, and this not is only total mess. The political elite of the European Union is so are a bunch of bigots, people also with even psychopathic people, even no, that they are not they are unable to reform and to transform the European Union in something democratic. There is not any democracy left in the European Union anymore.
It wasn't designed for that. It wasn't designed for that.
It wasn't designed for that, for being a democratic, let's say, it wasn't for that. There is no democracy anymore left in the European Union. There is no economic growth. There is no freedom. This is just simply dogmas. It's like the Virgin Maria in the times of the medieval age, and the Inquisition. The Inquisition, right now, is the media. The media are playing like the Catholic Church, together with the intellectuals. Many intellectuals, mainstream intellectuals, or what Antonio Gramsci was calling them organic intelligentsia. The organic intelligentsia are professors, analysts, political analysts, that are working in think tanks and important universities. Those guys are defending dogmas, the doctrine of the European dream.
And getting paid very well for
the European dream doesn't exist. It's an European nightmare.
Yeah.
The European nightmare that I saw with my eyes when in this February were bombing here the pro-Europeans, the center of Donetsk. I saw with my eyes.
Okay.
And then I saw, look, this is not a dream. This is a nightmare. You understand, you know? Yeah.
Okay, Miguel, one last question.
Yeah.
Let's go. What would you say if somebody...
You can show here, no? Because it's very...
Yeah. What would you say if somebody told you you were a journalist?
Journalist?
Yeah. If someone said to you, you're that journalist,
you reject...
How would you feel about that?
Very bad, because I'm not really a journalist. I am simply a blogger, no? A blogger is a person that is writing, what I am thinking about, you know, and also what I see with my eyes. You know, I don't have any political agenda behind. Nobody pays me. I mean, I will not write something that I don't believe. You understand me?
And what do you think?
You know,
what do you think of the journalists then?
Many journalists they are working as a journalist because they don't have other profession. I mean, they cannot do other thing. And people that are not able to do a proper job. You understand me? So they don't have the option that to be journalists. You know? So many of those guys will be unemployees. With people without, they don't have other option that to work. Many of them are people without any kind of some of them should be even face justice because they are participating, telling lies, and working actually. Well, they are doing that because money. That's it. Without any kind of ethics, and then thanks to the social media, people like me. That are normal people or people that are independent, let's say, are able still to tell some truth about some facts, no, that I see with my eyes here. This is not invaded by the Russians. The Russians have invaded the Donbass, never. You understand, you know? And then this city has been bombed. Yes, who bombed this city? Poroshenko and the pro-Europeans. You understand me? Here the people don't want to be Europeans. They want to be people from Donbass. They want to be out of the Euro-Atlantic axis. You understand me? They want to be part of NATO. And you have to understand that. You have to accept that. No, they are not able to accept that. It cannot be. Yes, there are people in this world, they don't want to be Europeans. They don't want to participate in this nightmare, call it European Union, including me, you know, that I am from Barcelona. Okay?
Okay. Thank you, Miguel. Gonzalo Bloga.
Thank you. So,